Colleagues from the media, good afternoon. COVID-19 pandemic has impacted the global economy, and the industry sector has indeed taken a large toll. Unido estimates that globally, manufacturing industries have been hit by a triple blow, with factory closures, supply chain disruption, and collapse in demand. In this context, as much as 21 out of 24 manufacturing industries experience negative growth rate. Amidst COVID-19, it has been the priority of the government of Indonesia to develop our industrial sector
to also build resilience after the current crisis. To get a better understanding on this matter, I'm very honored to be joined by Pak Agus Gumiwang Kartasasmita, Minister of Industry. Shortly, Minister Kartasasmita will elaborate more on efforts to develop the national industry to support economic recovery post-COVID-19. And after that, Professor Wiku Adhisasmita will also convey some updates. Colleagues, the past 7 days has been a big week for ASEAN as well as for the issue of Palestine. Let me update you on this development. First is on ASEAN. In preparation of the summit, the ASEAN summit on the 26th of June, which is tomorrow, yesterday, the ASEAN foreign ministers gathered virtually for a series of ASEAN meetings. I participated in 3 ASEAN ministerial meetings, namely informal ASEAN ministerial meeting, or AMM, and then ASEAN Political Security Community meeting, or APSC, and ASEAN Coordinating Council, or ACC. Several pertinent points highlighted during the meetings. First, ASEAN should not be trapped in rivalries between major powers. ASEAN is committed to promote cooperation with all partners to create a peaceful, stable, and prosperous region. ASEAN must be united to reiterate the importance of respecting and upholding universally recognized principles of international law, including 1982 UNCLOS. During the meeting, we discussed also development in Rakhine State. The Secretary General of ASEAN briefed the meeting on the follow-up of the formation of ad hoc support team in ASEAN Secretariat, financed by Indonesia. Voluntary, safe, and dignified repatriation should remain the priority. In this connection, ASEAN will continue to implement recommendation of preliminary need assessment, or PNA, including projects related provision of basic services. To develop trust, confidence building, and strengthen social cohesion, the FM radio programs will be launched to disseminate information in Rakhine State. Still on the Rakhine issue, I brought the issue of both people and requested that preventive measures and early detection should be taken to prevent them from taking unsafe journey at sea. It is very sad to see that the Rohingya people are also victim of smuggling and trafficking in person. As I speak now, I had received information that yesterday, Indonesian fishermen and authorities have helped 94 people from Rohingya ethnicity in the northern part of Aceh. To be more exact, it's on the name is a bit difficult to pronounce, Seunudon. Seunudon Waters in the northern part of Aceh. So among these 94 people, there are 49 women, 15 men, and 30 children, 10 boys, 20 girls. And based on humanitarian consideration, we give these people emergency assistance. At the same time, we will continue to work with countries in the region through various mechanisms on early detection measures, as well as to prevent both people to take unsafe journey at sea from the country of origin. I underline that the issue of boat movement cannot be separated from the root causes of refugees in the region. Accelerated repatriation process is key. Now, back to the ASEAN meetings. During the meetings, Indonesia also raised the issue of Palestine. I underline that the planned annexation of part of West Bank by Israel will be a blatant violation of international law and various UN resolutions. In this regard, I call ASEAN countries to act in unison to support the right of the Palestinian and reject Israel's continued violation of international law and UN resolution. And lastly, during the ASEAN meeting, I emphasize that ASEAN must be prepared to face the new normal through adjusting its working methods, in utilizing ASEAN Secretariat building, and in preparing ASEAN community building post-2025. Colleagues, in the last 7 days, diplomacy related to issue of Palestine was high in the agenda. I participated two important meetings on Palestine. One is UNRWA Extraordinary Virtual Ministerial Pledging Conference on the 23rd of June. And then just last night, I participated in the UN Security Council meeting on Palestine. And this meeting was initiated by Indonesia, Tunisia, and South Africa. On UNRWA Pledging Conference, the purpose of the conference was to gather financial support for the work of UNRWA. UNRWA is the United Nations agency that provides assistance and protection for millions of Palestinian refugees in Syria, Lebanon, Gaza Strip, the West Bank, and Jordan. I myself visited one of the refugee camps in Jordan in March 2019, and I saw with my own eyes the Palestinian refugees still have glitter of hope that keeps them alive. But the hope of the Palestine looks bleaker now, as the refugees face the COVID-19 situation and the threat of Israel's plan to annex West Bank. To add, UNRWA is now confronted by financial challenges. With the current funding shortfall of $800 million, UNRWA will not be able to provide 5.5 million Palestinian refugees with most needed humanitarian assistance. Therefore, amidst all difficulties that all countries are facing right now, including Indonesia, we still have heart and commitment to the Palestinian people. During the meeting, I underlined supporting UNRWA means supporting Palestine. Therefore, Indonesia has pledged to increase its financial contribution for UNRWA. On top of that, Indonesia is also committed to render financial support for Palestine through the Government of the Palestine and ICRC, and continue its technical and humanitarian cooperation with the people of Palestine. So that is about the UN Roa Pledging Conference. Now let me brief you about the UN Security Council meeting virtually on the Middle East process, including the Palestinian question that took place last night. Colleagues, I started my intervention during the meeting by saying, for far too long, the Palestinian people have suffered injustice, grave violation of human rights, and deteriorating humanitarian situation. With the looming threat of annexation, the future of Palestine is at stake. During the meeting, I also raised 3 points on clear dangers of Israel's formal annexation. First, formal annexation constitutes a clear violation of international law. Allowing Israel annexation means setting a dangerous precedent that occupying the land of others by way of annexation is lawful under international law. I address the need to jointly and strongly object in all international fora that annexation is illegal. Second, formal annexation is an open challenge to the Security Council. Credibility and legitimacy of the Council rests on whether they will act against the official declaration of annexation. Third, formal annexation will destroy all prospect of peace, including the two-state solution. This is high time to embark a credible multilateral peace process based on internationally agreed parameters and to support UNRWA to address humanitarian needs in Palestine. Colleagues, on Monday, 22nd of June, I also received a phone call from the Foreign Minister of Saudi Arabia, who officially informed me on the decision of the government of Saudi Arabia regarding the Hajj pilgrimage. I appreciated very much the call and fully understood the decision taken by the government of Saudi Arabia. And just yesterday, I congratulated the new foreign minister of Timor-Leste, Her Excellency Adelgisa Magno. I look forward to working with her to strengthen bilateral relations with Timor-Leste. And I also reaffirm Indonesia's support toward Timor-Leste application for membership in ASEAN. My last point is the status of Indonesia returnees per yesterday, 24 June. In 3 months' time, started from the 18th of March until 24 June, more than 117,852 Indonesians have returned home. This is an additional of 3,265 people in a week, or 2.8% increase. 84,718 Indonesians have returned from Malaysia so far, so we are seeing an increase of 2% from last week. 24,542 Indonesian crews have returned from 32 countries and arriving Indonesia through 5 entry points in Jakarta and Bali. And this is an additional of 1,245 people compared to last week, or 5.3% increase. Furthermore, 8,592 Indonesians have returned home via self-repatriation from 51 countries, which shows an increase of 4.1% this week, an additional 337 people. This number also covers 7 Indonesian returning from South Korea and one Indonesian from Jordan yesterday. The Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Indonesia continues to extend assistance to Indonesians abroad in need. Between 18 March to 24 June, Indonesian Embassy, Consulate General and Consulate in Malaysia have distributed a total of 306,194 packages of basic needs. Indonesian diaspora in Malaysia also help in distributing an additional, it's not distributing, but also contributing an additional 109,168 packages. Thus in total, there are 415,362 packages distributed in Malaysia. And if we combine with the rest of the region, we managed to provide in total 485,521 packages globally. So colleagues, that is all my points for today. Now allow me to invite Minister Kartasasmita to convey some updates. I thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone, especially members of the international press. Thank you, Minister Retno, for initiating this virtual press briefing and for allowing me to share Indonesia's industrial policies in response to the COVID-19 outbreak. It has been a tough few months for all of us, and challenges we face now are at an extreme high. As Indonesia is now starting to reopen for commerce and businesses, allow me to provide the latest information on several key issues pertaining to Indonesia's industrial sector. Despite many challenges faced by manufacturing sector, industrial sectors remains to be the largest contributor to the GDP, which amounted around 90%, although the utilization of industry has experienced a downturn from 75% prior COVID to currently 40%. Although we may see a lower growth at the first half of this year, we are adamant that with the policies we have and continue to put in place, our economy will gradually begin to rebound by third quarter this year. The government has been applauded by significant and progressive industrial policies in the face of this pandemic. The most important policy issue has been the issuance of set of policy that have allowed factories and manufacturing facilities to safely operate during the PSBB or large-scale social restriction. Both domestic and foreign industrial companies, in matter of few hours, have been able to obtain industrial operational and mobility permits, which allow them to continue operations. To date, we have issued about 18,000 of such permits that we believe represents a total workforce of 5 million people. In parallel, the government provided various lucrative fiscal and non-fiscal policies for both manufacturing industries and potential new investors. Fiscal stimulus for affected industries included relaxation for import tax, income tax, value-added tax restitution, an income tax allowance for individual enterprise. In addition, the government is also offering a super deductible tax up to 300% of companies undertaking R&D and up to 200% for those providing vocational development. Ladies and gentlemen, members of international press, fully supported by these policies, we feel confident that our national industries are steadily taking its firm stance in facing the challenges arising from the global pandemic. This is clearly seen in particular by key industrial sectors that are leading Indonesia's self-reliance in tackling the disease, such as medical devices, consumables, and pharmaceutical sector. In medical devices and consumable sectors, our industry has now the capacity of producing up to 3 million pieces of N95 masks and 4.7 billion pieces of surgical masks per annum to meet the approximate yearly domestic consumption of 172 million pieces. Our industry has also been able to mass produce up to 648 million pieces per year of PPE, hazardous material coverall, to meet the annual domestic consumption of merely 11.3 million pieces per year. This adds up to the ability in meeting the domestic demand of cloth, washable mask, and surgical gown. Some of our hazmat coverall products have been tested and passed AATCC, American Association of Textile Chemists and Colorists standards, be it AATCC 42 for water impact tests or AATCC 127 for hydrostatic pressure test, as well as the international standard for coverall protection toward biological hazard and liquid, set by ISO 16604 level 2. Today, 6 out of 16 domestic producers have been certified as they prepare to export and meet global demand. For ventilators, one of our local company is now preparing mass production for emergency type ventilators in mid-July 2020. While the production of the ICU type of ventilator will take place at the end of July 2020. We are so proud to highlight that in the process of manufacturing these ventilators, the industry has been able to produce locally all mechanical components which could take up to 80% of total required components. I'm also proud to say that these figures, these numbers, show that our national industry is not only capable of meeting local consumption, but also capable to meet global demand. Ladies and gentlemen, members of international press, our pharmaceutical industry, which consists of more than 220 companies, which 90% of them are still focusing on downstream sector, such as drug formulation. On the other hand, the upstream industry gap is forcing Indonesia to spend approximately $712 million per year to source raw material from abroad. To curb its dependence on imports, we are collaborating with key stakeholders to formulate policy and regulation in establishing conducive industrial ecosystem that allows Indonesia to be self-reliant. Furthermore, stepping into the new normal COVID-19 phase, we are aiming to achieve 35% of import substitution by the end of 2020. In order for this to happen, we are in the process of drafting policies that I am certain will attract both foreign and domestic investors to invest in import-substituted goods production, as well as boosting the use of locally produced raw materials and intermediate goods. We will continue to improve the quality of industrial-related policies for sustainable industrial growth and supporting investment in Indonesia, both domestic and foreign. As one of the world investment destinations, Indonesia is closing in to become ASEAN's production base for the global producers and rise as a major player in the global value chain. I think that's all I can say for right now. And since that I have to leave this video conference earlier because I have some other commitment, so I would like to take some questions, maybe two questions from media. Is there any? Okay. So, currently, we are in discussion with various investors, and we are trying our best to cater all of their needs. Our main concern now is to ensure that industrial estate and facilities have long-term infrastructure that includes energy supply and logistical access. To ensure that, one of many options is to readjust plans, and to readjust development from Brebes to Batang. Batang is, for me, a better location. It has more facilities in place and good proximity to international airport. Indonesia also has developed 114 industrial estates throughout Indonesia, which already equipped with access as well as facilities. And these are could be a good option as well for investors. Next question. From the beginning of the crisis, we have strived to ensure that manufacturing sector continues to service as the backbone of economic growth. In order for this to happen, our ministry issued industrial operational and mobility permits, or IOMKI, to secure business continuity of industrial activities under strict health protocols. As a result, manufacturing industries was able to record added value of 700 trillion in total and employment of 18 million people. We are also doing the pivoting of business models of micro, small, and medium enterprises. This pivoting allowed them to shift their business to produce protective equipment such as masks, gloves, and goggles. This helps the nation in gearing up and avoid shortages in PPE. And just last week, we are now able to assist in providing the global demand of such equipment. From a sales side perspective, both producers and retailers are also moving from offline to online platforms. This itself is a blessing in disguise to boost our short and medium long-term plans in developing Indonesia's Industry 4.0 plans. Our challenge, of course, is what is happening in other countries. We have seen a significant decrease in domestic demand, especially for non-primary products. However, we are optimistic to expect a rebound by third quarter this year. Our ministry and other government institutions are working very hard with producers, distributors, and also retailers to attract public consumption of goods and services. Maintaining strict health protocols, such as physical distancing, in factories have reduced industrial utility levels, reduced productivity, and increased cost. The solution would be the implementation of both fiscal and non-fiscal policies to help manufacturers maintain a healthy cash flow, including super deductible taxes for those engaging in R&D and vocational training. Ministry of Industry is pushing for electric and gas costs for industry to be proportionated. Our ministry is also pushing for flexibility in financing or refinancing for manufacturing industries. We are also establishing import substitution policy, as well as incentive for SMEs and labor income tax borne by the government. Opening of new industrial estates with huge and flexible incentives will be also our priority. Thank you so much.
So thank you very much, Minister Kartasasmita, for your briefing and for responding some question from the media. And Minister Kartasasmita has to leave the briefing room for another appointment. So once again, terima kasih, Pak Menteri. Colleagues, let me now invite and give the floor to Professor Wiku Adhisasmita to convey some updates. Professor Wiku, the floor is yours.
Her Excellency Minister for Foreign Affairs, Ibu Retno Marsudi, Minister of Industry, Bapak Agus Gumiwang Kartasasmita, my esteemed foreign correspondents and journalists, for more than 3 months, we have been battling against coronavirus pandemic. Even though this is a tough task to do, we could see lots of positivity spark amongst us. We could see the tendency of collective collaboration or gotong royong. More than 30,000 volunteers are working with us to assist health workers alongside with other donation and charity movement amid the crisis. There are more than 1,600 reference hospitals prepared across Indonesia. More than 200 laboratories are affiliated in our systems, carrying more than 20,000 samples testing every day. Indonesia honors every single individual involved, directly or indirectly. This shows how much we could accomplish as a nation and that we always could break boundaries we thought existed. Another big news we should be proud of is that Indonesia, home to one of the biggest textile industries, is able to produce its own coverall gown, a very crucial protective gear for health workers, especially in isolation rooms designated for COVID-19 patients. These coverall gowns have been produced under several corporations, and we entitle the union as INA United. All of them have gained international standardized certification for level 3 protection, which is maximum, which means that there are eligibles to be used in operating in isolation rooms. We are very proud and hope that they could be widely distributed and utilized by health facility across Indonesia. COVID-19 has become a global issues infecting nearly 9 million people and causing almost 500,000 deaths. According to the statistics from the WHO, with the last update on the 23rd June 2020, American continent got the worst impact of this pandemic, as half of the global COVID-19 confirmed cases came from this continent. Southeast Asia is the region with the fourth largest number of confirmed cases after Europe and Eastern Mediterranean. Among the death cases, there are hundreds of even more of healthcare workers who lost their lives during the battle against this deadly coronavirus. PPE shortage and insufficient quality are some of serious global issues that claim a number of healthcare workers' deaths. Moreover, the WHO has published their insight that the coronavirus may never go away. Surely, the issue of the PPE shortage and insufficient quality need to be fixed to prevent more deaths of our heroes in this long-time battle. Indonesia, as the fourth populous country, has a potential strength to tackle this issue. Indonesia has a company that is the top 10 largest polyester manufacturers in the world in 2019. To add, Indonesia is ranked 6th in the largest textile producing countries in the world in 2020. With these known records, Indonesia can produce a huge number of PPE, which majorly require polyester fabrics. We do realize the great potential of our beloved nation, thus we made the first coordination involving multi-sectoral parties, including WHO representative for Indonesia. We found that Indonesia has an alternative material to enable us to make a huge amount of PPE. In months, we have been able to do a large-scale production of internationally standardized PPE coveralls using this abundant material. As you can see, these are some examples of the PPE coveralls we made. The coverall produced by domestic textile industries turned out to be made of the better fabric, more durable, and more cost-effective compared to those that we have been using, those that there are imported. Indonesia is hopefully able to fulfill the need of the PPE coverall independently. Moreover, we encourage this potential to soar far and contribute to supply the high global demand of the PPE coveralls. Our trade policy should be in line to fulfill global needs amid the pandemics, hence enabling us to boost export for PPE products after the nation needs are met. In such a crisis, humanity is above everything else. We should always look up to opportunities where Indonesia could contribute more for the world, and this is a token to humanity. Once again, we would like to refer to all individuals and elements involved, including the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Ministry of Industry, also Ministry of Health, and the Ministry of Trade, that have helped us tremendously during the efforts in formulation and development of INA United. Now, I will answer questions from the media. Question from Nikkei Morocco News Agency. Many local governments demand for the COVID-19 test not to be expanded for preventing the rise of positive cases. How will you persuade them that it's important for tracing as much as case for better prevention for spread? Which region in Indonesia has recorded better management of the epidemic and why? We at the National Task Force always ensure the regions to always increase testing capacity. Increasing the testing capacity and making positivity rate below 5% are public health indicators that we are used to identify risk zones. As far as we know, there are some areas in Indonesia that have a better pandemic management response and can be reflected in how much they have a green zone and also have much tracking and testing they do to control the pandemic. We see some rejection from people, and we think that is caused by pervasive fear. As the government, we should always educate our citizens, including local authorities, and approach them persuasively to tackle the emerging panic. Public communication is very important. It is our responsibility to always educate people, to give them understanding that screening is imperative, especially for the contact tracing. Tracing is compulsory in outbreak mitigation. Such epidemiological data is required to help the authorities to take measures in accordance with the local situation. The regional government was once worried about testing because they were afraid that if they had a significant rise in cases, they would enter the red zone. This is not true. However, in our opinion, it was a good start, for they have the deepest care to COVID-19 mitigation process. When we told them that the assessment of a zone was not only based on positive cases, but also based on the readiness of the health services, they were very enthusiastic to improve it. It is human nature to frighten things that are not understood. So we always emphasize understanding to back them up. A second question from Moroccan news agency. Has Indonesia set new health protocols for the next recovery of tourism in the country? On the 22nd of June 2020, the National Task Force announced 29 conservation tourism that are allowed to be opened. Those that had been allowed to gradually reopen are all in the green zone, meaning there is no positive case detected in that particular area. Measures must be conducted under stern health protocol, collaborating with local authorities. They are only permitted to have 50% visitors of the normal capacity. We also call upon the Ministry of Environment and Forestry, Ministry of Marine Affairs and Fisheries, and Ministry of Tourism and Creative Economy to cooperate in order to achieve safe and conducive environment for the conservation tourism. The tourism sector for leisure resembles school. Both have quite high risk of virus transmission category. We are doing such measure preparations in recovering such activities. The third question from Moroccan news agency. What is the assessment for the evaluation of the epidemic 1 week after a partial containment of Indonesia? The National Task Force has been monitoring all districts and cities in 34 provinces using an integrated real-time data system called BLC. This integrated system can be used to assess both districts and cities that implement the partial containment and do not. Therefore, the central command controls all districts and cities in Indonesia. As we brought up yesterday with the president, once the good news of this week's evaluation is that there are 38 cities or districts that has showed a tremendous progress in the mitigation. These cities and districts had no added cases for the last 4 weeks, which transforms them from orange or yellow zone to green zone. After more than 3 months, we are grappling with the pandemic. COVID-19 mitigation has brought us far. Our data system, Bersatu Lawan COVID, established in March, has now become more integrated and more real-time than ever. In years and time to come, even post-pandemic, the system could hopefully be enhanced to develop an integrated data system for any disease surveillance, providing accurate and holistic data bank for the epidemiological purposes. Thank you very much, and I would like to return this to the Ibu Retno. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Wiku, for updating us, including on the capacity of the medical equipment, especially on the PPEs under the INA United. I think it's very encouraging. Well, colleagues, now my turn to close this briefing by responding question related to foreign policy. On the question, first is on the question by Nikkei, NHK, Voice of Vietnam, regarding what are your expectations, the expectation of Indonesia and hope of Indonesia about the upcoming ASEAN summit. Colleagues, the ASEAN summit will be an opportunity for the ASEAN leaders to further consolidate and coordinate effort to mitigate COVID-19 and its impact, focus effort on economic recovery, as well as to address recent developments in the region. For Indonesia, this summit will be an important opportunity to address two essential things. First, ASEAN must strengthen its relevance and centrality amidst geopolitical challenges, especially in the face of increased major power rivalries in the region. Second, ASEAN must increase its collective capacity to mitigate pandemic and strive for economic recovery in the region. Next question, I would like to respond to the Voice of Vietnam on views regarding Vietnam's preparation to host the ASEAN summit. Colleagues, with the pandemic, this is an unexpected and unprecedented year for all of us, including for ASEAN. So adjustment must be made, but Vietnam has shown a good leadership so far. And then question by Nikkei on whether ASEAN should bring a strong message on South China Sea issues in the statement. On the South China Sea issue, colleague, ASEAN should continue to send a clear and strong message on the importance of respecting universally recognized principle of international law, including 1982 UNCLOS. And ASEAN must reiterate its position to ensure that all countries contribute in creating a peaceful, stable, and prosperous region. And then next, I would like to respond the NHK question regarding the difficulties in doing diplomacy during this pandemic time, as it is hard for diplomats to carry out face-to-face negotiation. Well, indeed, we are facing an extraordinary and unprecedented situation for the work of diplomacy. Again, adjustment is needed, but I'm sure that face-to-face negotiation and meetings remains important in diplomacy. So again, though traditionally negotiation is always done by face-to-face, but we have to adjust it, but I'm still very sure that face-to-face meetings and negotiation remains important in diplomacy. And then related to the question from Moroccan press agency on the latest development of Indonesia's international cooperation in the fight against COVID-19, I would like to update that as of 24 June 2020, Indonesia has collaborated with 117 international partners, comprising of 11 countries, 12 international organizations, and 94 NGOs. We have also facilitated international business-to-business support for 15 entities. And then Moroccan News Agency and Kyodo asked a question on the views regarding updates on travel bubbles. I think I have explained this in my last briefing, and I will update you again once there are new significant developments. Next, I would like to respond to the NHK question on the progress regarding diplomatic note on South China Sea sent to UN. Again, I have addressed this last week, and I mentioned that the second note that Indonesia sent was on the 12th June 2020, and there are no further updates. And now I will answer question from Moroccan Press Agency on when Indonesia plans to open its air border. And again, I have responded this question last week, and I shall repeat again that this policy is subject to further evaluation based on the development of the situation. May I come back to the question on the update travel bubble on top that I mentioned to you that I will update you when there is significant development, but so far we had discussion with a number of countries. Of course, what I would like to underline that this talk on the possibility of having essential business travel bubble consider, of course, the strict health protocol implementation. So what I would like to say is that the health protocol consideration is part of the negotiation on talk of the essential business travel bubble. And again, I will update you whenever there is some developments on the talk, because, you know, there is talk, there is discussion. Not all of this discussion I can reveal right now, but what I would like to convey to you is talks with a number of countries are there. And then lastly is on the question by Moroccan Press Agency in regard to latest report on COVID-19 relating to the foreign community in Indonesia. Per yesterday, there are 332 positive cases, 9 deaths, 214 have recovered, and 494 are ODP, or people under monitoring, and 277 ODP foreign national have been repatriated. So, colleagues, once again, thank you very much for being with us again for this press briefing for today. And of course, thank you very much for Minister Kartasasmita and Professor Wiku who join us for today's press briefing. So once again, thank you, and I'll see you, inshallah, next week. Bye.